Good afternoon, my darling. Hello, world. This is Mr. Willem, and Mr. Willem is rather annoyed. Because I've been reading a book. A book about H.P. Lovecraft, whom I admire. And this new book is called A Haunted Mind. Let me just read a portion of the back blurb. In A Haunted Mind, Dr. Bob Curran explores what motivated Lovecraft. His personal life is just as strange as some of his creations. And drove him to create his terrible cosmos. Using both folklore and history, Dr. Curran investigates a wide variety of Lovecraftian mysteries. A word of warning! You may never look at Lovecraft or the world in exactly the same way again. Unfortunately, the biographical matter in this book seems to be written by a man who has his head up his ass. He repeats myths and lies about Lovecraft's personal life, things that never occurred, things that we know are not true because we have the evidence of Lovecraft's friends who wrote about Lovecraft. And many of those essays are published in this Arkham House book, Lovecraft Remembered, which is a huge volume of reminiscences about Lovecraft. There are some few people who found Lovecraft odd, but most of the people who really knew H.P. Lovecraft did not find him a freak or an outsider at all. Besides those essays written by Lovecraft's friends and associates, in which they tell that Lovecraft was a very ordinary and a very charming and a very intelligent individual, we have H.P. Lovecraft's published letters. Now, I confess that is a very strange, macabre image of Lovecraft, but obviously the eyes are not real. The eyes have been touched up and helped to make Lovecraft look far more freakish than he actually was in life. So, I mean, this has become a common theme of mine, that H.P. Lovecraft was an ordinary individual who possessed an extraordinary imagination. He was not a freak. Honey, I know freak, okay? I know what it is to be freaky. Hello. Hello. I am the authentic Lovecraftian eccentric recluse. Lovecraft wasn't a recluse. Perhaps for a short period of time in his early life. But when he matured, he spent the majority of his money traveling, being with friends. He was not this thing that people like to paint, this outsider who walked around only at midnight and haunted Providence at night and lingered in graveyards dwelling on death, or whatever the stupid, pathetic myth is that is being weaved about H.P. Lovecraft. So the biographical matter, the very first portion of this book is biographical, and it is absolutely horrible. Here we have, by any stretch of the imagination, Howard Phillips Lovecraft was more than a bit odd. He was not the sort of person you would invite to a dinner party, though it's doubtful that he would have come if you had. He was certainly not the life and soul of a gathering, and by all accounts he was not even an easy conversationalist, preferring to confine his exchanges in long, involved, essay-length letters. None of that is true. Not only did people invite Lovecraft to dinner, they invited him to stay at their homes for weeks at a time. Weeks. They were so delighted with his charming company. He was an exceptionally amusing conversationalist. He was funny. One only needs to read his letters to see that Lovecraft had a rich comic vein. He was humorous. He was as humorous as he was intelligent. So, right at the start, this person, this doctor, Bob Curran, is telling lies about H.P. Lovecraft. Lies that we know are not true. I'm getting wound up, Mother, because I'm pissed off. I'm plucked, girlfriend. I'm annoyed at the world treating H.P. Lovecraft as if he was some ghoul, some freak of nature. No, no, he was not. Yes! I'm wound up, Mother, yes! Bit of a drama queen. Anyway, it's... So the first portion of this book really, really annoyed me. And he says things like... he's talking about Farnsworth Wright, the editor of Weird Tales. Wright took it upon himself to change and edit some of the works without consulting Lovecraft, and he also rejected some of his submissions, including The Shadow Over Innsmouth and At the Mountains of Madness, telling Lovecraft that they were not up to the magazine's high standards. Great Yagath, what a load of ichor. Weird Tales' high literary standards? Excuse me? At the Mountains of Madness was not up to Weird Tales' high literary standards. This is bullshit. Hello. The reason that The Shadow Over Innsmouth and At the Mountains of Madness were rejected by Weird Tales was because of their length. And because Wright insisted that they were not easily divisible, so that they would be published in segments. It had nothing to do with Wright telling Lovecraft that the works were sub-literary and just didn't fit the high standards of writing for which Weird Tales is renowned. What utter nonsense. So the first part, the introduction, and it's quite lengthy, of this book convinced me that this is just a worthless book. Don't waste your money, don't waste your time. However, then we get to the sections regarding the Library of Lovecraft, the creations of Lovecraft, Nyarlathotep, the places that Lovecraft invented, the Dreamlands, Arkham. Now, I know nothing about Dr. Bob Curran. I'm just going to read the little biographical note. It says, he has traveled throughout the world, fascinated by the myths and stories that he has found. He has written a number of books, including Vampires, Lost Lands, Forgotten Realms, Zombies, and Werewolves. Fascinating fellow. All four new page books. He lives in Northern Ireland with his wife and family. Now, so at first I was rather depressed and nonplussed, because as I began to read the sections on the Necronomicon and especially when I came to the section on Nyarlathotep, which is quite lengthy, I had to revise my opinion of the book. The section on Nyarlathotep is extremely good. It's very good. And what is revealed in this book is that the author actually knows a lot about folklore, esoteric books, the history of magic, and he is extremely well versed in the history of the Clu mythos and those who work within it. And as such, I cannot dismiss this book out of hand. I actually have to say that if one is a writer of Lovecraftian weird fiction, this book has merit and interest, both as a history of Lovecraft's use of myth and the connection of Lovecraft's invented myth with actual folklore and such, and the history of the mythos is well defined in this book. And so once one gets past the really bad introduction, this book becomes for me really valuable and fascinating. So I do have to recommend it. If one is a fan of the Cthulhu mythos, if one is an author of modern Lovecraftian fiction, this book is worth investigating. So it's almost that the author felt compelled to paint Lovecraft as a freak, because it was perhaps expected of him to do so by the publishers. Another writer who treated Lovecraft in a similar fashion was, what's the dude's name? Can't remember his name, which is probably, he has a story in, he wrote a book, he's an occultist, and he wrote a book about H.P. Lovecraft. I cannot now remember the name of the book, or bollocks. He has a story in the new Black Wings Volume 2. I know all the rest of you all know who I'm speaking of, the occultist who wrote that book about Lovecraft, and he painted Lovecraft as a complete oddity, emphasizing what he felt was the odd nature of Lovecraft's personality, and it was all completely bogus. And then he had some really outlandish ideas about Lovecraft's fiction. I will say that this book is actually a better book, because the majority of the book deals with the mythos as invented folklore and its association with actual myth and folklore. So there's my little spiel. For biographies of Lovecraft, the best is I Am Providence by S.T. Joshi. Without doubt, the finest. To read the life of H.P. Lovecraft, we are getting more and more of his letters published. And they form the basis of a rich autobiography. And they tell that Lovecraft was not this oaf who during the daytime he stayed in his rooms, but he drew down the blinds and would light candles so he would feel like he's writing at nighttime, and whether he hated the sun. H.P. Lovecraft loved the sun. He was always going out to parks on sunny days to write postcards and letters. There are so many myths and lies about H.P. Lovecraft by people who don't know what the hell life they're talking about. And we are at a point in time now when those myths and lies should have no validity whatsoever, and that they can be written of again, expounded in a brand new book, is really appalling. But if you are into the mythic aspect of Lovecraft's writing, not a bad book at all. So I hope you all are having a fabulous week, and I shall see you later. Shalom, my darling.